hear you sing it.
To just sing it with you. It's really a great song, and really just, I don't know, the moment we first started doing it here at this church, it became one of our favorites. And so I just want to encourage you to sing out to God, to worship Him with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and all your strength. Broken and lost, you found me, though hurt had been my way. Called as a child and righteous, you broke the power of sin and freed my heart. You saved me, and I'll be forever yours. emptied yourself in rescue. You opened up my heart to know your cross. And held by the power of freedom, you broke the lies and found me in your truth. You saved me, and I'll be free. All God's people will sing it out. You made me free to be. You saved me. You saved me, and I'll be forever yours. Oh, come on, let's do this. You made me free to be forever yours. I will love you, God, and I will stand and worship, and I will give you praise. Till my hands are raised, and I release my pride. Sing it out together. Lift your hands, lift your heart, and let's sing it out to Him. You saved me. You made me free. You made me. Let's do it one more time. With all we've got, you saved me. You saved me. Let's give Him some praise this morning. Clap your hands. I tell you what, He is good. You guys are wonderful. Go ahead, Mark.
Did I interrupt the song?
No, you did great.
I was like, oh, he's not done yet. I'm sorry. Hey, before you sit down, I know, sorry, stand up. Why don't you guys greet everybody? Go shake someone's hand, give them a hug, high five them, mow their lawn for them, do something. I know, I was like,
look, they're learning how when to sit down.
All right, now you grab a seat. Hopefully you had a chance to greet somebody you didn't know. If not, maybe there's somebody in your row, which we'll talk about here in just a second. My name is Mark Massaro. Welcome to Anderson Hills. We are so glad you're here for this morning. What a beautiful morning, huh? How about this, Gary? Let's give God some praise on that. Beautiful. If you are a guest here, we'd love to connect with you. We want to give you an Orange Leaf gift card. All you have to do is there's one of these little connect cards in the seat back in front of you. Fill that out, take it to the Welcome Center, which is right outside those doors, and we'd like to get all of our new guests some frozen yogurt. I know it was kind of chilly this morning, but it is going to warm up. For everybody, we'd also like to have you have the black pads. Somebody raise one of those black pads up on the end of the rows there for me, would you? So, there we go. Fill those out. Send it on down the row and maybe greet somebody that you're really not sure what their first name is. Make sure you say hi to them at the very end as well. We have a couple of bins. One's over there. One's over there. That's our offering bins. Little slots on the side. Just go ahead and put your offerings in there. And on top, we have Bibles. So if you forgot your Bible today, go ahead and grab one. Or if you want to raise your hand up really high, one of our ushers will be happy to bring you a Bible as well. And if you don't have a Bible at home, we'd love for you to have one. It's our gift to you. If you know of maybe your next door neighbor doesn't have a Bible, take an extra one, give it to them. It's a great way to introduce them to the church and just kind of get a nice introduction going. Okay, how many of you like to read? Raise your hand up. You like to read. How many of you like kids? Why do your hands go down when I say that? The early service, like half of them. To all the guests, we really do like kids. I just want you to know that, okay? Well, if you like both, we have about 8 Mount Washington Elementary School kids that will not have an opportunity to have a reading tutor unless we get some volunteers. So if you feel compelled, if God is tugging on your heart to do that, there's some information in your weekly. Also, there's some success stories about that. These kids are so appreciative of the tutors. So if that feels like that's you, then make sure you take care of that. Let's wake some people up this morning, shall we?
You got it. Well, I tell you what, this morning we are in our final week of the series called Fight Club, and it's things that we fight for in our families and in our homes. And today is called, Is There a Vampire in Your House? We'll explain that more later, but it's really going to come down to, are there people or are there things that tend to drain you? And how do you recover from that? How do you deal with that in a good and a biblical way? So we're going to be talking about that this morning. So we just wanted to guide in there using just some great worship as an opportunity to love on God a little bit and open us up to that. So we're going to sing a song we've done a few times. It's called Wake Up, and you guys join us and sing.
From our souls, oh, is the
Not I will, but yours be done. Oh, here we stand, our hearts are yours. Not I will, but yours be done. Here we stand, our hearts are yours. Not I will, but yours be done. Oh, here we stand, our hearts are yours. Not I will, but yours be done. Oh, here we stand, our hearts are yours. Not I will, but yours be done. Oh, here we stand, our hearts are yours. Not I will. I gotta tell you, it's been such a great and awesome morning in worship. We're gonna do one more song before the message. And if you follow the church on Facebook, you've seen this come out all week long. And it's this beautiful song called I Am. And if you're going through struggles in your home, if there is issues of tension and conflict, in that area or any other relationship, I love the words to this. When you put that chorus, it's from God's perspective. And he says, I am holding on to you. I am holding on to you in the middle of the storm. I am holding on. I am. And so I just pray that we would let that sink in this morning.
There's no space that is love. There's no place where we can't find peace. There's no end to amazing grace. Now take me with your arms spread wide. Take me like an orphan child. Never let go, never leave my side.
I am holding.
This is my resurrection song. This is my hallelujah come. This is why it's to you I run.
We want to hear everybody sing us.
This is my resurrection song. This is my hallelujah come. This is why it's to you.
I just want to, you just go ahead, you can give him praise. That's cool. You can clap. Yeah. God, we just want to come before you, God, and just thank you for what I find to be a really strange, a really odd love that you give us, God. Just like we were just singing through that middle of the storm, sometimes we're the ones that create that storm, God. And we just take advantage of the fact that you are always going to love us, even though that is so weird, so strange, so amazing, so not of this world. We don't see that modeled anywhere in this world, God. We let stuff and things get in our way and suck our time and our energy away from you, God. And I know that I'm guilty of that. And I ask your forgiveness. And I know that I'm probably not alone in this room when I say that. We've all got this stuff, this baggage, whether it's self-created, family-created, generationally created, God, we want to give that up to you. We just want you to convict our hearts and show us the sheer awesomeness of what it is that you give to us, that you offer us every day. God, I love you. I just ask that you would let your Holy Spirit be in this place and in this message that we are going to hear today. Let your words be spoken. God, we love you. I love you. Amen.
Don't be scared.
Just kidding. Do you constantly feel as if you're walking on eggshells? Does every conversation end in an argument? Do you struggle to pull things out of your children? Are you constantly stressed, anxious, or worried about something? Is there estrangement, anger, a lack of trust, deception, unhealthy secrecy, favoritism, jealousy, addiction, divorce, defeatism, pessimism, selfishness, greed, laziness in your home? Can I get a witness? No one deals with any of that. Okay, well, next week we'll be, no. Help, you say, there's a vampire in my house. And this thing, whatever it might be, is sucking the life from my family. What is dysfunction? According to Merriam-Webster, dysfunction is the condition of having poor and unhealthy behaviors and attitudes within a group of people. So again, what is it for you? What is sucking the life out of your family? What is causing you to wither? You're like the Wicked Witch in the Wizard of Oz. I'm melting, melting, right? There's something in your home, more than likely, that is sucking the life from the home. And I'm not asking so much today, who is it? I'm saying, what is it? What is the dysfunction that you are dealing with? Some of us are able to identify the dysfunction in our home, and we can do so relatively easily. We see the dysfunction for what it is. Now, I didn't see dysfunction in my home until I had really grown up and moved out of the house. And let's just say that in the last 6 or 7 years, I've realized that dysfunction existed in my home, even growing up, on a level that I never realized. One form of dysfunction in my home was what I call pride. I come from a prideful family. My father, in particular, my grandfather before him. And so for me, I have to battle pride. And for most of my young adult life and my early married life, I had to really battle pride, and I still battle pride at times. But it was bad. It was sort of a judgment thing, you know, where it was real easy for me to look to the life of others and say, oh, well, he needs to fix this and she needs to be better at that. And, you know, it was just an easy thing to do. And what I had to discover later on was that that was largely due to the fact that that's the way it was for me growing up. I always heard my family, you know, point the finger. Well, they this, or they're that kind of people, or, well, you just got to, you know, you got to give them some grace because they've always been this, and, you know, or he's a hothead, or she deals with this, or, well, they, you know, they have this, or pride. Others of us struggle maybe a little more to identify the dysfunction in our home. Why? Because we probably grew up in a dysfunctional family, and therefore chances are we may just assume that the patterns are normal. We don't know anything else. My father-in-law, this has been 3 years ago now. We're on a road trip together. And when I started dating my now wife in high school, I would go over to her house and I would hear her father talk to her mother in ways that I had never experienced as a kid. Harsh words. Words that just tore down. There was no edification. It was simply tearing down. And so we were on a road trip in the car, and I was the navigator. Don't ever recommend being the navigator for my father-in-law. Was struggling to read the map and exactly, you know, what it was saying, and I got the, oh, just someone, you know, that kind of talk. And I'd had it. And so as the son-in-law who'd listened to this for 12 years of marriage and for 6 years of dating prior to that, 18 years of his 33, 31 at the time years of life, I decided I was going to put him in his place. I will not be talked to as though I am beneath you. Conversation continued from there. We won't elaborate. Well, he was devastated. And we got to our destination, and a couple of days later, I was in conversation with Christian's mother, and she said, you know, Greg was really hurt by what you said. What? I'm the victim here. I was the one hurt by what he said. He's got to learn that he can't talk to people that way. Matt, you don't understand. He doesn't realize that he talks that way. You see, for him, It's not this hateful talk, this nasty talk, this degrading talk. It's just speech. And that's how you talk to people. Because that's how he was always talked to. Generational dysfunction. Maybe it's in your home. Often some of our deepest personal problems are rooted in something that we cannot control. Dysfunctional family behavioral patterns that came long before us. And hopefully, after today, will not still exist long after we're gone. To put it into our context of our title, once you have been bitten by dysfunction, you become dysfunction. Unless you take the necessary steps to overcome it. So here is my encouragement for you today. While we cannot change our past, we also do not have to be a product of it either. It's not as easy as just rewriting our past. We can't go back and change things. What's done is done. But amen, hallelujah, God's word, the truth of the gospel says that we don't have to be a product of our past either. We can control our choices for the future, and each of us can choose to breathe life back into our existing family structure. The cycle of dysfunction can and has to stop with us. So the first thing I would address with you this morning is, how do I deal with dysfunction? It's in my home. I see it. I know it's there. What are some steps I can take to deal with it? First thing, offer what people need, not what they want. Now, most naturally, we would assume that this principle applies to parents and children, the child-parent relationship. And it does. But this also applies to your married relationship. Or for those of you who are single, unmarried, and do not have kids, this applies to your relationships with other family. Or take it anywhere you want. Dysfunction can exist in the job. Dysfunction can exist in any kind of relationship. Offer what people need, not what they want. Give good gifts. Nothing wrong with that. God is a good gift giver. Offer advice. Lend support. Encourage, love, and serve your children and your spouse. But don't spoil, don't enable, don't become a crutch, don't encourage bad behavior, don't love and serve to a fault, and certainly don't become a slave. Give people what they need, not what they want. Set healthy boundaries. This rule applies also to both children and adults and takes us back a few weeks to our discussion on values. Many of you remember we encouraged you to go home and have a conversation with your children about what values exist within your home, what's important to us as a family. The boundaries that you establish in your home can be and should be built around what you value. For example, if the value is we want to make Sunday morning worship a priority, then the curfew on Saturday nights and the activities that we allow our children to participate in may change. Or if the value is we want to honor God with what we put in front of our eyes, then the television programs and the movie choices that we make for our children may change. A value that we have in our home, for instance, deals with issues of honor and respect. Children should respect one another and their parents. Wives should respect their husbands. Husbands should respect their wives, and moms and dads should respect their kids. It works all the way around in our family. Boundaries deal with the ways in which we are allowed to communicate with one another, the consequences of disobeying, and the expectation for both an apology and an acceptance of said apology or forgiveness when it is appropriately delivered. In other words, when we disrespect our kids, we go back and apologize. And when they disrespect us, we expect an apology. In both cases, forgiveness is granted. Ephesians 6, verses 1 through 4. Paul says this. He says, "Children, obey your parents because you belong to the Lord, for this is the right thing to do. Honor your father and mother. This is the first commandment with a promise. If you honor your father and mother, then things will go well for you and you will live a long life on the earth. Fathers, do not provoke your children to anger by the way you treat them. Rather, bring them up with the discipline and instruction that comes from the Lord." What an amazing promise. Honor your father and mother, things will go well for you, and you will live long and prosper. What is it? Is it? I don't even know. Third thing we have to do in order to deal with dysfunction is to face the consequences together. I would add the word together in there. This rule applies to both children and adults as well. In our home, people are allowed to fail. I don't know about your home, but in our home, we're allowed to fail. And thank goodness, because we do a lot of it. We're allowed to fail. We're allowed to mess up. And listen, there will always be a consequence to poor decisions. There will always be a consequence. But moms and dads, allow yourselves to face the consequences of messing up in marriage. And do so together as a couple. Allow your children to face the consequences of messing up. But face those consequences with them. And don't, please, 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 don't rescue them from their consequences. Don't make excuses for them, and certainly don't play the blame game. Well, it's the teacher's fault. Well, it's the coach's fault. You're teaching them to go out into the world, and the first time they get a job, and the first time they're reprimanded in that job, to say, "Oh, well, it's just the boss's fault. I'm done. I'm out of here." And the fourth thing we must do is to always forgive. In Colossians chapter 3, verses 12 through 14, Paul says, "Since God chose you to be the holy people that he loves, you must clothe yourselves with tender-hearted mercy, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Make allowance for each other's faults and forgive anyone who offends you. Remember, the Lord forgave you, so you must forgive others. Above all, clothe yourselves with love, which binds us all together in perfect harmony." Always, always forgive. So, what if the dysfunction exists because it existed before me, and it existed before my parents and my parents' parents? How do I break the cycle of dysfunction? Because it's one thing to deal with it in the home. It's another thing to break the cycle and to say the buck stops here. Often the dysfunction continues until someone realizes that he or she can actually break the cycle. So we're here this morning to empower all of you, to encourage all of you to say, if dysfunction exists within your home and you know it's there, you can pinpoint it, then by all means, by the grace of God, break